We're here in the Brough Superior corner of my garage. I've got a few Brough Superiors, and I keep some of the memorabilia on the walls here. That's Lawrence of Arabia, probably the most famous Brough Superior owner, along with George Bernard Shaw. He had 7 Brough Superiors. Actually, if you've seen the movie Lawrence of Arabia, you know he was killed on one, avoiding a drunken postman. In fact, I have the New York Times, May 19th, 1935, Lawrence of Arabia dies of injuries after a 6-day fight by doctors. I've always been a Lawrence of Arabia fan. If you try to read his book, The 7 Pillars of Wisdom, it's almost impossible to read. But there are some Brough Superior quotes in there, and he refers to the motorcycles quite a bit. As you can see, I was a young man when I got my Brough Superior, rather thin with black hair. Another handsome chap, I must say. This actually hung in George Brough's office, something he had hanging over his desk. I was fortunate enough to get it. And today we're going to talk about probably the most famous Brough Superior model of all time, the Brough Superior SS100. Come on, let's take a look. To my eye, there's no more beautiful bike than the Brough Superior SS100. This is a 1930 model. Has a JAP 1000cc engine. They call it a Jap engine. Now, that's not some derogatory term. That stands for J.A. Prestwick. J.A. Prestwick built most of the engines for Brough Superior. And George Brough was a fascinating man. His father produced motorcycles. And as a young man, he decided his father produced the Brough. And over a couple of pints in a pub one night, George decided to build his own bike and called it the Brough Superior, which caused his father to get a little annoyed, thinking his was the Brough Inferior. And they never quite were on the same plane that way. His father built more practical motorcycles, whereas George loved sporting high-speed road bikes. Although they only produced 3,000 Brough Superiors in the whole 21-year run of the factory, every one of them is collectible. The Brough Superior is probably the most collectible bike of all time, right up there with the Vincent Black Shadow, and of course the American Crocker as well. George Brough used proprietary parts. He got the best engine, the best chassis, and he put them all together. He didn't actually build any engines himself. He bought the best materials he could. And in the early part of the 20th century, a lot of the best materials came from England. It's an overhead valve, it's 1000cc, it's called an SS100 because every one of them was guaranteed to do 100 miles an hour. And I must say, it still has the most beautiful gas tank in the history of motorcycle. Every Brough has some variation of this. Some are a bit more bulbous. This model here, the 1930, represents George at his peak. You know, as a young man, George Brough wanted high-speed, lightweight racing motorcycles, as this one was. By the time he got a little bit older, like the late 30s, the Brough Superiors got a little bit bigger, saddles got a little bigger. They went to the MX4, the matchless engine, a little bit more comfortable, more of a high-speed touring bike as opposed to an all-out racing bike. I've said this a million times, I like a motorcycle you can see through, and when you look through this, your eye falls to all sorts of nooks and crannies, kind of like that giant English muffin thing. There's 1,000 little nooks and crannies. This is your oil tank here. This has what they call total loss oiling. You fill a tank up with oil, you drive it a few hundred miles, your oil has disappeared. Where'd it go? Went somewhere. Just goes out, gets used, doesn't get recirculated, and you put more oil in it. Of course, everybody went to pressurized lubrication stuff by the mid to late 30s. You can also add a little bit of oil extra. If high-speed road work, you give that a couple of pumps and it'll shoot a little more oil. This is your Pilgrim pump right here. This is a fascinating little doohickey. You look down and through that glass window, you measure how many drops of oil. There's a little meter there, you can adjust it and see how many drops per minute you're going. This is your gear shift lever here. You have a 3-speed. You have a foot brake. You have a hand clutch. Before you start a Brough Superior, there's a million little oil valves and things you have to open. And God forbid, if you forget to open one, then your engine seizes. Ah, I forgot to open that one. These forks are what they call castle forks. They're really just a copy of the Harley-Davidson fork. I think even the most ardent Brough enthusiast will give you that one. These are your friction dampers here, pieces of wood in there. You tighten these down or loosen them depending on how much play you want in your front end. This is the Bunnickson speedometer. I've yet to figure this out. It is the most complicated speedometer. You have 2 needles, each moving different ways. They go tick, 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 click, and that's your speed. Tick, 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 click, and that's your speed. If you're looking at this when you're riding, you'll hit something because you'll be mesmerized. How fast am I? Okay, let me see. Ha! And then you're dead. So just don't pay any attention to it. It works, but better men than me have failed to try to figure out exactly how. You got two filler ports for tanks. This is your light switch here. Beautiful stove enameling, the black with the gold, it's beautiful. And these saddlebags, beautiful saddlebags. All sorts of interesting little things. This here is a chain oiler as well. You open that up and it drips oil on your rear chain. This is a primary chain lubricator. You fill it up here and you open this and it puts oil on your primary chain there. Dual float carburetors for excessive, you know, speed. So if you've always got enough fuel on hand so you don't starve if you go around a corner. Your battery box is right here. This is what you call a rigid frame motorcycle. There's no suspension on the bike itself, although the seat itself is sprung. There are springs in here, and that actually works quite well. So it keeps the motorcycle tracking fairly true. You know, later British bikes had that plunger thing, which is kind of all over the place. Whereas this, when you get on it, as you can see, you got a little bit of bounce there. George Brough initiated a lot of interesting ideas. The first guy to connect the mufflers and dual prop stands and a number of other things as well. But they were all extremely high quality items. These were called the Rolls-Royce of motorcycles. They got that name, I think a man named Teague, I believe he was the editor of the Motorcyclist in the 30s. He rode one and called it the Rolls-Royce of motorcycles, which kind of, annoyed Rolls-Royce. And as the story goes, this might be an apocryphal tale, the Rolls-Royce representative went out to meet George Brough, and George heard he was coming, and he put all his men in white lab coats and gloves and had them assembling motorcycles, and the Rolls-Royce man walked in and said, "Wow, this is unbelievable." Like, "Oh yes, yes, we always wear gloves when we assemble." And he was so impressed by the cleanliness and the workmanship of the bike that they allowed George Brough to use the name the Rolls-Royce of motorcycles. Now, it must be true because he continued to use it all through his life. Fairly lightweight bike, very, very mechanical, much like looking at the back of a watch. When everything else was flatheads, this had overhead valves. And believe me, 100 miles an hour in 1930 is pretty fast. These were extremely expensive motorcycles in the day. Whereas Harley-Davidson would produce something like 28,000 motorcycles a year, in 1930 they made 21 of these. That was it, 21, and 21, we're exhausted. But it's a wonderful bike to drive. You can actually drive it as a modern motorcycle. The brakes are not really good. The front brakes, well, let's just say they're not only not anti-lock, they're anti-stop. These has anti-stop brakes, so the nice thing is you can jam on the brakes and not worry about being thrown over the handlebars, because at best, you might slow down. You want to use accident avoidance technology when you drive this, which is, look out! You know, the horn is not going to scare anybody. You're pretty much on your own. Your only hope is that the vehicle that's coming at you will be so entranced by its beauty that they will sacrifice themselves so as not to hit you. Well, that's about it. It's probably time to go for a ride.
There's a lot to do on these old bikes. You've got advance, you've got retard, you've got a hand clutch and a hand shift. You have a foot brake and a hand brake. You've got a couple of choke controls. There's a lot of stuff to do. When this bike was built, there wasn't a whole lot of traffic. As you can see, for an 80-year-old motorcycle, it pulls away quite nicely. You know, I like these big old twins. They have a nice cadence. They're like riding a horse. And extremely comfortable. You can adjust the seat up or down. I'm a pretty tall guy and I'm not cramped on this bike. Drop it into high. 60, 70 miles an hour, no problem. She'll still hit 100. It gets a little scary, but she'll still do it. I think George Brough would be amused to see that so many of these bikes have become museum pieces. He really did build them to ride, and that's what they're meant for, high-speed riding, even modern high-speed riding. You can break the speed limit in this thing today just like that. Imagine what it was like in 1930. Then when you get up to about 65, you drop it in third, and you're away. Kind of feel like Lawrence of Arabia. You kick it up a gear, and then you take off. Not exactly speed shifting. But I love that feeling when she clicks into gear and then you open the throttle again. Great fun!
I'll tell you
what the controls are like from the rider's point of view. This here is your clutch. This here is your compression release. You pull that back when you're going to kick it over, and that raises an exhaust valve. You're kicking over 1,000 cc's. It's a pretty hefty motorcycle. So by pulling that lever in, that raises the valves, you can kick the motorcycle through a little easier. This here is your advance and retard. This here is your choke. This here is an extra oil pump. If you're traveling at high speeds and you feel it's starting to do a soft seize or tighten up on you, you give that a couple of pumps like that, and that'll shoot a little more oil to the bottom end. This here is your front brake. This here is your gear shift lever. You know, modern bikes are nice, they're fast, they're comfortable, but nothing has as much character as these old motorcycles. This is one of the great motorcycles of all time, the Brough Superior SS100. You know something? I'm gonna go back and watch Lawrence of Arabia again. See you later. And try to make it through that seven pillars of wisdom. It's very hard. See you next week. Bye-bye.